Welcome to my lecture on parallel algorithms, concretely the second part of the chapter on parallel sorting. So last time we looked at sorting algorithms for relatively small inputs, where we saw that a relatively really simple algorithm that just gathers the data to a single processor is, as to be expected, effective only for very small inputs, at least if you have a huge number of processors. Then we saw the kind of intermediate results that a slightly inefficient algorithm that still gets us some speed up is actually good for very small inputs, and that as expected, an asymptotically efficient algorithm based on quicksort, if you implement it well, can be a fast algorithm for intermediate input sizes. Today, we want to talk about the largest input sizes, where we can also expect to have really efficient algorithms for parallel sorting, but where we have to be very careful about the amount of communication. So the problem with the quicksort algorithm was that all the data was communicated a logarithmic number of times, log number of processors. And now we want to look at algorithms that communicate the data only a constant number of times, possibly only once. Okay, so let's start with a simplifying assumption. We want to generalize quicksort to use multiple PVOs at the same time. Okay? And now, as a simplification, let's assume that we know perfect PVOs, meaning that we have PVOs Vi, k of them, where Vk is the element with rank k times n over p. And we have p PVOs, I'm sorry. To have a uniform notation, let's assume that there's also PVO V0 that's smaller than all the elements and a PVO Vp that's larger than all the elements. Okay. So, and I have here a pseudocode, that's our usual single program multiple data thing. Okay, so each processor initializes P messages that are intended for one message for each processor, including one for itself to have everything as orthogonal as possible. So then each processor goes through its local data, the elements d0 to dn over p minus 1, and it finds a, a bucket index k such that the local index, local element di is between pvos vk and vk plus 1. And then it puts this element into the message nk. And then these messages are sent to the processors. So each processor sends p messages, one to each processor, including one to itself. And then it receives the corresponding messages. So this is another collective communication operation, namely it's called all-to-all personalized communication. Note that the message lengths might be quite different, but we know that each processor sends exactly n over p elements and receives exactly n over p elements. That's because we know that globally there will be exactly n over p elements in each of these buckets. Yes, and then each processor has one bucket of elements that are larger than everything on smaller numbered processors and smaller than everything on larger numbered processors. and it just has to locally sort the received data. And note that this means data is communicated only once. So let's analyze this algorithm. It's a time for the local distribution. You have n over p elements, and we need time log p to find such an element, for example, using binary search. We will need at the end time t sequential of n over p for local sorting, where this is something like n over p log n over p. And we need time for a data exchange involving preprocessors and a bottleneck communication volume of n over p. So basically, these two terms sum to something like the sequential execution time divided by p. Particular note that these we have n over p times log p here, n over p times log n over p here. If the constant of proportionality is one in each case, we can say that's okay, that's n over p times log p plus log n over p, which is simply n over p log n, right? And then log n is a sequential execution time. We will later see an algorithm that does this data exchange with something like running time 2n over p times beta plus p times alpha, where alpha was a startup overhead and beta was a factor of proportionality for measuring network bandwidth. We might actually hope to have a 1 here, although we will see that for the general case, that's not so easy. And as a side note, if for some reason that what you actually want to do is a permutation where you can immediately compute the rank of an element, then our simplifying assumption is actually realistic. But let's stick to sorting now. Namely, we now want to refine the algorithm so that we can approximate this even data distribution efficiently. And that algorithm is called sample sort. And I'm showing you the part for finding the pivots. So the idea is that we choose A times P random elements, where A is called an oversampling factor. And for example, one approach would be that if all processors have the same amount of input data, they could each choose A sample elements. Then we are sorting the samples and then set the ith pivot to the element of rank S, A times I in the sample. So we are basically perfectly partitioning the sample. And if this, we will show that if the sample is large enough, this is a good approximation of pivots that globally split the actual input elements. And as a side note, we don't really have to sort this. We have to do something that we could call multiple selection. So we have specified ranks from an unsorted input and want to extract the elements of the right ranks. And if actually A is very large, we can do that more efficiently than by sorting the sample. But in practice, we will usually make sure that the sample is not too big. And then that doesn't make a big difference. In particular, if we make sure that we use a fast sorting algorithm here. So let's look at an example. We have three processors here. We want to sort these characters that are evenly distributed over the processors and say the bold elements are our sample elements. Then, for example, we could gather the sample elements at processor one and sort it locally there. We have 3, 6, in this case, 8 sample elements, so I didn't choose a uniform number of samples here, but it doesn't matter. And as uniform splitters, we could choose the C and the J, right? Then there are always two between two of the splitters. So that means all the characters smaller than C go into the first buckets. The letters between C and J, but smaller than J, go to the second bucket, and the letters larger or equal to J go to the third bucket. So then every processor does that locally. We see that processor one has no small elements, but 3 medium-sized ones and 4 big ones. Processor two has 1 small, 2 medium-sized, 4 big ones. Processor three has 1 small, 2 medium-sized, 4 big ones. And then these buckets are exchanged so that processor one gets all the small buckets, this, this, and this. Processor two gets the medium buckets, this, this, and this. Processor three gets all the large buckets. And then we sort locally. So that was not a particularly good balance. And it actually turns out that if you want to have good balance, you need fairly large samples. But for large input, it actually works out fine because the samples may be large but still small compared to the input size. And that we want to actually analyze asymptotically now. We will show that an oversampling factor of log n over epsilon square suffices such that with high probability, so in this case 1 minus 1 over input size, no processor gets more than 1 plus epsilon times the average number of elements. We analyze that for a situation where we don't take local samples, but each sample is chosen globally, uniformly at random with replacement, meaning that it's in principle also possible that some sample elements are chosen, input elements are chosen several times as a sample. And that's a particularly simple one to analyze. And let me note that there's also an efficient algorithm to implement this global sampling on a parallel machine using very little communication. So it's not considerably more expensive than this local sampling that I have proposed previously as a means of simple implementation. But I also guess that one could analyze the algorithm with local samples. Okay, so how can we prove this? So let us conceptually look at the inputs in a sorted order, E1 to EN. Yes? Now, what does it mean that we have an imbalanced result of our splitter selection? This means that there is some processor that gets more than 1 plus epsilon times n over p elements. But this is only possible if there's some segment in this sorted sequence of size 1 plus epsilon times n over p that gets less than a samples. And we call this event EJ. Okay? Well, there are only n such segments, right? One for each starting position j. So an upper bound for the probability that there is some segment is n times the probability that for a particular j we have this failure. So the failure probability is less than or equal to n times the probability that for a fixed j this segment gets less than A samples. We also call this a union bound, which is very often useful in parallel computing to show that nowhere anything goes wrong. So how can we analyze this probability? So let us define a 0-1 random variable xi that is 1 if the ith sample is in this range and 0 otherwise. With this definition, we can define the sum of the xi and then the probability that we have this failure event ej is simply the probability that the sum x is less than a. So what's the expectation of a? That's basically 1 plus epsilon times a, right? Which in other words means that x less than a means that x is less than 1 over 1 plus epsilon times the expectation of x. And if you look at the asymptotics of this 1 over 1 plus epsilon for small epsilon, for example, using a Taylor series development, this is basically the probability that x is less than 1 minus epsilon times the expectation of x. At a very good approximation, or more precisely, that's a first order approximation of this ugly thing. And I'm doing this massaging of the formula because this constant factor deviation of a sum of random events that are independent is something that one finds in the analysis of probabilistic algorithms again and again, and there are well-developed tools for handling this situation. Yes? So let's fix a few more parameters. X is the sum of the xi. The expectation of xi is simply the probability that xi equals 1, and this is 1 plus epsilon over p. Okay? Now we have all the information needed to apply this tool I was talking about. It's one of the several forms of a so-called Chernoff bound. And this Chernoff bound we will use as a black box. I'm just stating it here. Let x be the sum of independent 0-1 random variables. Then the probability that the sum is less than 1 minus epsilon times its expectation is less than or equal e to the minus epsilon squared expectation divided by 2. So now plugging in the values for our problem, we get that the probability that the sum is less than a is less than or equal e to the minus epsilon squared, then this 1 plus epsilon times a is the expectation of x divided by 2. And the epsilon we can actually get rid of because that's less than or equal exponent e to the minus epsilon squared times a over 2. And what we actually want is that this is less than or equal 1 over n squared. Why 1 over n squared? We want to apply this union bound, right? So we want to multiply the probability with n, and then the failure probability should still be small, namely 1 over n. That means we achieve this if this probability is less than or equal 1 over n squared, because then we multiply it with n for the union bound and get a remaining failure probability of 1 over n, if that's what we want to prove, right? So we want to have this relation. We can simply solve it for a now, which is equivalent to a is larger or equal to 4 over epsilon squared times ln n, which is what we wanted to prove, right? It's we have this quadratic dependence of epsilon. So there's a constant factor of 4 in here, which is not too bad. But the bad news, of course, is it's a quadratic dependence of epsilon. So if you want to have a really, really good load balance, like 1%, then this gets a factor of 10,000, which makes sense only for huge inputs. But if you are fine with, I don't know, 20%, then this is something quite reasonable. So sample sort allows you to do sorting in a reasonably load balanced way, but really good load balance is only directly possible for huge inputs. But anyway, it's a simple, elegant algorithm with low overheads. So let's plug this into the analysis of our algorithm. This is the running time basically for the idealized algorithm. The only modification we have to do is that we insert this 1 plus epsilon factor here, and we have the additional cost for handling the sample, which we will do in these two terms. One is the time for sorting the sample, and now we could plug in any parallel algorithm for using p processors and an input size of p times log n over epsilon squared. Recall the oversampling factor was order log n over epsilon squared, but we need p element, p times that many elements for our sample. And then we have to gather together all the splitters so that all the processors know all the splitters, and that's this cost here. It's another collective communication operation, an all gather that collects data together, broadcasts it to all processors. It's also called all-to-all broadcast. So this is not that interesting. It's something like beta times n over p communication overhead that's a sufficiently large input, that's fine. But it's, I think, quite instructive to look at what this term gets for different parallel sorting algorithms, or maybe not so parallel. In any way, we will show that this overall term is small if the input size is large compared to p squared times log p. So we already get an indication here, sample sort is good for large elements. For quick sort, we had something like n has to be large compared to p log p. Now it's p square log p, so it's much more coarse grained. but the communication overhead is less. But what exactly we have here is, I think, an interesting study in scalability analysis. so what could we use for sorting the samples? We could use this naive gathering algorithm, the gather-merge algorithm that we used in our experiments, then, of course, a fast ranking algorithm. We could use parallel quicksort, or we could even recursively call sample sort if we have huge samples, right? And then they would recursively maybe use one of these algorithms. But let's analyze it in a bit more detail. We can basically plug in the running time of these sorting algorithms for small inputs here, and then find out for which n this gets small, right? And that's what I did, and maybe just believe it to me, but it's also a nice exercise to try that out. And in the exam, I might ask you to derive one of these functions. So actually, if you use a naive algorithm, we will get this p square log p that I have claimed before. Then actually the bottleneck is the local sorting. Actually, we discussed that in the last exercise, right? where we said, okay, for in some case, really the local sorting is a bottleneck if you use this naive algorithm. And then the, therefore the constant of proportionality is something the time for comparison divided by this epsilon squared thing. Which basically means that for good load balance, this can really be a big bottleneck. It gets already better to some extent if we use this gather-merge algorithm that doesn't do the sorting locally, but whenever data is moved together, then we get rid of a logarithmic factor, a log p factor here. However, then this take comparison is replaced by the beta. So, and if the time for comparison is much smaller than the time for communicating one element, then actually we haven't won a lot, right? We just got a different bottleneck here about the communication. Or in other words, if this is actually a log factor, log p factor larger than this, then we should have looked at this term here that also shows up in that algorithm actually. But anyway, asymptotically, we already won a log p factor, and we can actually get another log p factor if we switch to the fast ranking algorithm. Interestingly, we don't win anything if we switch further to parallel quicksort. It's also not a bad choice, but actually the bottleneck then becomes the gathering of the pivots, so it doesn't give you a real added advantage. And similarly, that's an indication that we don't have to do something like recursive sample sort, at least not asymptotic. And we will actually also see that there's a competing algorithm, multi-way merge sort, and it actually has this asymptotics in the scalability. So we see that the sample sort is actually still quite good for our setting. So let's further look into sample sort, and I will once again show you an MPI code that basically shows that this is really something that can be implemented relatively easily. So that's the source code that we show also in our book, and it was provided by Michael Axmann. Many thanks to Michael. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 slides. So it's actually a little bit more than this quicksort thing I showed you. But the difference is that now we get a practical sorting algorithm that you could really use in applications. We will later see that it competes quite well. So let's look at this code. It's actually also already a generic algorithm where we could plug in any element data type. So that's templated C++ code. So we have here our parallel sorting code. It gets passed a communication context of MPI, an input vector of local data elements that are to be sorted, and a data type. So we are assuming that our elements are actually mapped to an appropriate MPI data type. Number of processors and the number within the processors. We are initializing a random number generator. And yeah, that's all basically the random number generator. And we are taking the local sample, which in this case is size 16 times log p. It's divided by log 2.0. because logarithm in C is the natural logarithm, right? And we want here the binary logarithm. So that's our oversampling ratio. And we implement here this local sampling algorithm that I have proposed. And we put them into a local array log S, accessing a random point in our local input array data. So now we are finding the splitters using, actually in this case, a naive algorithm. Okay, then we are allocating a vector that has enough space to take all the samples. And then we use the MPI all gather operation, the all-to-all broadcast, to replicate all the samples to all the processors. So what's the signature of this all gather operation? We are so we are passing basically a pointer to the to this vector, to the content of the vector we're passing a pointer to the content of our local sample data. So that's the data we want to send. We tell it it's this size. We tell it it's this type. And then we pass the content, so a pointer to the content of the large array where we want to collect the sample, and that's the size. Actually, this is multiplied by p, the same type, and this is the communication context, right? Then we are using the standard template library to sort the global sample, and then move the splitter elements, namely every a plus first element in this implementation, to the beginning of the array, and then later resize it to size p minus 1. And since we have done that redundantly for all processors, there's no need to actually broadcast the splitters, because we already broadcast the entire sample, which is probably not optimal, but the hope is, of course, we this will be a lower order term if you have sufficiently large input. So this is targeting a simple implementation rather than one that's optimal in all possible cases. So now comes the first part of the heavy local work, namely we partition our data locally. So now you're also getting a kind of small course in advanced C++, because so somehow it's interesting, this MPI stuff is very low level. We are basically going down into the implementation of the vectors, because the MPI wants to get past pointers, right? But now we're working locally and we can use advanced C++. It's a bit schizophrenic. But anyway, so we are allocating a vector of vectors of elements, namely a vector of size p, one of buckets. Each bucket is itself a vector of elements. Okay? We are reserving enough space in each bucket to take twice the expected amount of data. So we are not talking about a super space efficient implementation here. But this gives us reasonably good performance, because this means that it will very rarely happen that we have to reallocate these arrays. If we would not use these reservations, we would adaptively grow all the bucket data structures. And that would cause a considerable overhead in memory accesses. Okay, now we are ready to do the actual classification for each element in the data array. We perform a binary search in the array of pivots, and that can be done with this upper bound function. And that's actually a pointer. Or that it's an iterator, but I can do something like pointer arithmetics with it. Namely, I subtract from this position in the pivot array, the beginning of the pivot array, and I get a bucket ID. And I insert the element into this bucket that I have determined with the binary search here. Okay, now comes the most ugly part of our implementation. It's just the preparation for the actual data exchange. So here we have maybe the problem that MPI is not really intended for handling irregular inputs. So the interfaces for data exchange of variable data sizes are a bit cumbersome, and that's why we have to do some a little bit ugly programming here. So what we are allocating here are four arrays of eventually size p or p plus one. S counts will hold the sizes of the sent buckets. R counts will hold the sizes of the received buckets. S displacements will give relative positions of where the actual data is stored for the sent buckets, and air dispels does the same for the received buckets. And yeah, for orthogonality, we have the first displacement is zero in the sent buckets. Now I'm going through the buckets and copy back the content of each bucket into the input data array. And at the same time, I'm recording the sizes of the buckets in S counts and accumulate the positions I used for copying the buckets. Then comes the first MPI all-to-all data exchange. But it doesn't exchange the actual data, but only it exchanges the bucket sizes. Yes? So it says, okay, what is sent? The sent counts. These consist of one integer each. And it will receive the receive counts, which are also one integer each within the communication context here. And then we compute the received displacements by basically summing up these data, starting with zero and then adding them up as we go through the receive counts. So and then we can wrap up. We allocate an additional array for received data and then make an all-to-all V count. So before I had the MPI all-to-all, that's a regular all-to-all where all the messages have same size. Here's a call where we have variable counts, and that means that now the input sizes are an array of input sizes. The data is here, and here's the displacement. So it's not as general as we might like. So it assumes that still all the data is received into a single array and sent from a single array. That's why we copied actually the buckets back into the input array. So here's a pointer to the sent data, an array of sizes for each message, and where they are stored. And then, yeah, it's this element data type, MPI type. And then the same thing for the received data. So the pointer to the beginning of it, the counts and the displacements, same data type and the usual communication context. And then the stuff that actually should take most of the time, if we have enough data, is this single line of code, basically a call to sorting the locally received data. And then we swap it back to the input data element. So from the outside, this looks like an in-place sorting algorithm, although we had to allocate a lot of local arrays to do the stuff that's working under the hood here. So let's look at running time experiments. One might get the impression, oh, this is an algorithm that is, I don't know, fairly naive. There are some things that can be optimized. This will never achieve the performance that you get in an industrial strength sorting algorithm. And the answer is maybe, maybe not. So let's have a look at this. We are comparing several algorithms here. The bottom one here is the code you have just seen. And let's look at that code first. We have a fairly large shared memory machine with four Intel 18-core processors. So overall, there are 72 cores and 144 hardware threads. Okay. And on the x-axis, you see the number of input elements per thread. And what we see is that for 2 million elements per thread, so a fairly big input, we achieve a speed up of close to 50, which one would usually consider as quite reasonable for a parallel sorting algorithm that might have other bottlenecks than internal work, like memory access bandwidth and so on. Performance then goes down, which means that, yeah, we probably have to do something about the memory management for really large inputs. That's my interpretation here. So it's not a perfect implementation. But now the surprise is that it outperforms several algorithms that one would have thought to be much faster. So particularly interesting is this thing. This purple line. This is a genuinely shared memory parallel sorting algorithm that is also in our book. And that actually turns out to be a little bit more complicated than this naive MPI code. And the big surprise is that the MPI program, so we are running here one MPI process on each core of a shared memory machine. So we are seemingly doing something that's not really very clever, because you say, oh, that must be some overhead. You don't really exploit the shared memory you have available. But actually, it turns out that the MPI program has much bigger speedups, except for these largest inputs where something apparently goes wrong. And the surprising thing is, I mean, this thing is already optimized for taking non-uniform memory access things into account. If you use an implementation of sample sort on shared memory that's as naive as the MPI thing we do, it would be even worse. It would stagnate somewhere here. Okay? So this program is more sophisticated, it's longer, it's more complicated, and still it doesn't achieve the same performance as a native MPI implementation running on a shared memory machine. The answer here is that the runtime system of MPI already does a few things that work quite well on shared memory machines. For example, it turns out that there is a performance bug in the Linux kernel that basically means that if you use large amounts of data, then the initialization of this data is done sequentially. Whereas we are circumventing this problem in the MPI implementation, because we have one Unix process for each MPI process, and then this initialization stuff is actually parallelized. That's one of the main things here. And I guess that also some non-uniform memory things are done automatically in MPI. Okay. Then there's a multi-way merge sort based parallel sorter that was in the past one of the best parallel shared memory sorting algorithms. That's out of the PhD thesis from by Johannes Singler, and it's now part of the standard library, at least in the GNU distribution. And it achieves speed up something like 25, but in a actually, for these biggest inputs, it's about the same. So it's also a reasonable algorithm, but it doesn't quite achieve the speedups we want. So we on looking at this so far, we would say we have the super surprising results that much more sophisticated implementations actually perform more poorly than our kind of trivial MPI program. But to show that better things are actually possible, we have here our newest shared memory parallel sorter, which is actually also sample sort, but it's in place. And it does a few things like data distribution in a much more optimized way. Also memory management, load balancing, all of this is much more optimized. And then we actually get speedups that are a factor of two better than our MPI implementation. They actually reach something like 85 here. So that speed up relative to the sequential sorter in the standard template library. And as you might guess, is that this speed up of more than 72 on a 72 core machine may not actually be absolute speed up, because this algorithm also running as a sequential algorithm is somewhat faster than the standard template library. But actually you also get the effect here that hardware, you profit from hardware threads, because the memory bandwidth of the machine can often really be exploited best by making use of the hardware threads. Okay. So now I'm more or less done with sample sort. And I also want to explain to you an alternative sorting algorithm based on multi-way merging. I mean, I've just said that actually sample sort works better than multi-way merge sort, but still multi-way merge sort has a number of advantages. In particular, it can balance the data perfectly between the processors. And we can use it in some other situations, like we have recently published a result on parallel string sorting, and their multi-way merge sort has distinct advantages because there it's more easy to optimize communication volume. But to keep things simple, I will explain to you just the ordinary sorting of unit of atomic elements that are not as complex as strings. So let's look at this picture first. So as an example, so suppose we have four threads, T0 to T3, and we are drawing the data in colors. So we color code the processors also, and the we can view it like something that the height here is a number we are storing for the key, right? And then in an unsorted input is like it goes up and down in some arbitrary way. So multi-way merge sort then starts by local sorting. So it's in a sense a dual algorithm to sample sort, where we are doing the local sorting at the end. But actually, after that, it's not that far away from sample sort, because we are also partitioning the input into small, medium, large, and large inputs. So, and I have drawn these partition lines, these black lines here in each of the four inputs. And they are chosen in a kind of compatible way. In a sense, we are also choosing pivots that define these points. So that if we say now we put elements in buckets as we did in sample sort, but now it's very easy because the elements are already sorted locally, and do this exchange of buckets, then since we have chosen consistent pivots here, we actually just have to sort locally, but now we can exploit again that this is actually partially sorted data, right? So we have P sorted sequences that we are merging into a single sorted sequence. So basically what we have to do is sort locally, partition in a coordinated way, exchange data, local multi-way merging, and then we have a globally sorted input. And the advantage of multi-way merge sort over sample sort is basically that we can exploit the sortedness of the local data to find better splitters. So previously in sample sort, we used a large random sample and then got a reasonable approximation of good splitters. Now we can find in a time that is basically a lower order term, perfect splitters. And I will explain to you how that works. So here's a pseudocode on a high level. So you have a local data array D and a global input size N, and a number of processors, P. Now it's a shared memory algorithm for now. So, and it's actually, in this case, a single global array that we want to sort. So then we say, okay, processor I just does sequential sorting of a subarray of D, namely the elements E times N over P, through E plus 1 times N over P. Then we do a global synchronization, a barrier synchronization. Now, notice each processor basically executed a sequential algorithm. So now again, each processor executes a sequential algorithm, namely, it finds a splitter element, a pivot element Vi with global rank E times N over P in the input array. Yes? So each processor works on a different rank, but it executes basically a sequential selection algorithm. It's a strange kind of selection because it exploits that the data is locally sorted into P-sorted subsequences, but it's a sequential algorithm, right? Then they do a barrier synchronization. And then again, each processor does something sequentially, namely it merges P-subsequences of the elements in the range Vk to Vk plus 1. So this is kind of interesting, right? I prepared this slide when I was invited to give a talk on parallel algorithm engineering at a conference for practitioners. I think that was organized by Heise Verlag or so. And the topic of this workshop was parallel programming. And most of the talks were on the greatest parallel programming languages, blah, blah, blah. And I was kind of the odd man out because I was talking about algorithms. And so I thought, okay, let's demonstrate people that maybe parallel programming environments are not always the crucial thing in getting good parallel performance, because the only parallel operation you have to do here is a barrier synchronization. And this can be done with whatever you want. You can do it in nowadays in standard C++. You can do it with OpenNP, whatever, right? You can implement it even manually in a maybe not so optimal way. And then otherwise, you perform most of your work in executing non-trivial sequential algorithms. And the overall thing is a quite competitive parallel algorithm. And that I found an interesting lesson that maybe sometimes algorithms are more important than programming environments. Okay, so what remains to do is to talk about how to implement these things. But I mean, we don't have to discuss how to do local sorting, right? It could be something like quicksort. And actually, maybe that's part of the algorithm engineering course I'm giving rather than a parallel algorithms class. Similarly, multi-way merging, yes, I think we even do it in the algorithms 2 lecture. But this selection operation here is kind of odd, and you probably haven't seen it here, so I will concentrate on this part. So the idea is each processor should determine a splitter with appropriate global rank, right? For a comparison bias-based algorithm, one can relatively easily see that there's a lower bound of omega p log n over p. But I will show you a slightly suboptimal algorithm that takes time p log n over p. So it is a log n factor slower, but it's simpler and more elegant. So this would be a relatively ugly algorithm, and I don't want to go into too much details for this particular problem. So the algorithm is basically very similar to the quick select algorithm that we actually already present in the algorithms 1 lecture. Anyway, I will explain the algorithm from scratch, and also there's a difference between, because the basic quick select works on unsorted data. Now we can exploit that we use sorted data. So for the algorithm, we maintain the following invariant. For each of the input sequences, we have a range, here's the colored ranges, where we know that the sort pivot must be somewhere within this range. And then, as in the quick select algorithm, we choose a random element from the remaining data. So we need an algorithm that can randomly sample an element from the union of these ranges. Okay? And that's this element V. And now comes the point where we exploit the sortedness of the local sequences. We can now locate the sampled element in each of the sequences using binary search. Of course, I mean, if we sample it from one of these sequences, in that sequence, we don't need binary search. But for the others, we have to do it, of course. And so then you see these brown arrows, they go to the location of the pivot in each of the subranges. Of course, I mean, in general, it may be that the position we found is the position of the next largest element. But we can take that into account. So we are counting the elements larger, smaller than or equal to the chosen pivot V. These are the brown arrows. And we are summing them up. And that's the global rank of the pivot V. And now we can go ahead the same way we do in the quick select algorithm. If V has a global rank larger than or equal to K, we know that the element we are looking for must be in the left parts of these ranges. And that's what I have marked here. And otherwise, they must be in the right part. And in a probabilistic fashion, this splits the set of remaining elements into a subproblem that has only a constant factor of the size. So if we repeat that order log n times, this will actually converge to ranges of size 1. And we have exactly located the place we are looking for. Okay, so I've written this down as a pseudocode. It's a sequential pseudocode, but it's, yes, a slightly non-trivial algorithm, right? So it's called multi-sequence select. It gets as input an array of sequences and an intended global rank k. And it outputs for each of the sequences a position of the element with the right rank, or the next larger one. So, and here it establishes the invariance, namely these ranges that are known to contain the right position are initialized to encompass the entire sequences. These are the invariants I talked about. And now we have a while loop that has to do something as long as there is some non-trivial subsequence left. Then it picks a pivot, maybe randomly. And then in each of the sequences, it finds a middle position for the range using binary search. And then it does this case distinction. If the sum of these positions is larger than or equals to k, then the vector of right borders is set to m, and else the vector of left borders is set to m. And then at the end, we simply return the left border values. So let's analyze this algorithm. It's kind of similar to the sample sort algorithm. We do local sorting in the beginning rather than in the end, but the running time is the same, something like n over p log n over p. We do merging. That's n over p log p. And in sample sort, we had this term basically for the distribution. So it's about the same thing. And we have this term for the multi-sequence selection. I don't have a cost here for data distribution because right now I'm talking about shared memory. And one can relatively easily see that this is efficient if n is large compared to p squared log p. Because if you substitute p squared log p here, you get basically p log square p for the local sorting term. And you will get the same fear. That's p times log p square something. That's order log p. And that's also order log p. So that's also p log square p. And actually same here. So all these, in that case, for the lower bound on the size, then all these three terms will be of the same order. If you then make n much larger, then actually this term will begin to dominate. Which incidentally is the same asymptotic scalability as we got for sample sort with a naive local sorting of the sample. Merge sort has the advantage that it is almost deterministic. I mean, I gave you a randomized algorithm for multi-sequence selection, but we could relatively easily here find a deterministic variant that's slightly more complicated, but achieves the same performance. And perhaps most importantly, it's it achieves perfect load balance. So if you would like to do the same with sample sort, you would have to have a subsequent data redistribution step that has additional communication overhead. Nevertheless, I have preferred sample sort here, maybe because the constant factors that are involved here in the merging are actually slightly worse. At least I know very fast data distribution algorithms that avoid branch mispredictions and so on. And all these tuning techniques don't work quite so well for multi-way merging. But as I said, there are cases where perfect load balance or better communication volume outweigh this thing. For example, we did that for string sorting. So, yeah, I said that maybe that's most interesting for a distributed implementation, and then maybe we want to do a different thing. Maybe it's also a good exercise to think about why directly implementing the shared memory algorithm is perhaps not such a good idea. So let's discuss about this in the flipped classroom part. So let's now redo multi-way merge sort parallel sorting on a distributed memory thing. And well, the local sorting and the local multi-way merging are fine. We can basically adopt them. But for the multi-sequence selection, I would like to have an algorithm that uses the owner computes paradigm. Every processor should work on its local data as much as possible. So the idea is that we basically perform the same computations as a shared memory algorithm, but in a way that every processor is responsible for doing the work on its local input. So each processor has one locally sorted sequence, but it has to work together with the other processors to do P minus one multi-sequence selections in a batched fashion. So we are basically running P minus one for P minus one splitters, P minus one multi-sequence selections. Together, each implemented in a parallel way. Yeah? And each of these algorithms has a logarithmic number of global levels of recursion. And we basically will batch that together also. As long as any of these multi-sequence selections hasn't terminated, this global algorithm will go on. Okay? So now we still implement this quick select based algorithm, so we are identifying pivots by random sampling. But we have to do that for each of these P minus one multi-sequence selections, right? So we are finding P minus one pivots, which we will gather together and broadcast to all the processors. Which is a collective communication operation that has a vector length of P minus one. So it's a kind of a long sequence thing, but not a super long sequence, right? But we have seen these pipeline broadcasting algorithms that work quite well here. Okay, now each processor knows the P minus one pivots, and it does a local binary search for each of these P minus one pivots, right? And then it knows the number of elements less than or equal to the pivots for each of the pivots. And then we do again a vector valued reduction, adding up these pieces. And we can use that information to find out for each of the searches in which half of the recursion they will be going. And if we are analyzing this, we get the following. We have a logarithmic number of global recursions. In each of the recursions, we have a constant number of collective communication operations that take time log p times alpha. And we are working on vectors of size p, basically, p minus 1 is only slightly smaller. We will have local work log n over p, and we will have to communicate these vectors of size p. So there's a term beta p in each of the iterations. So let's look at this also in the form of single program, multiple data pseudocode. So each processor distributed multi-sequence select gets a sequence of local elements. And an array of ranks. In this case, I use p rather than p minus 1, but doesn't matter. And it outputs an array of positions, meaning it's local splitter position for each of the ranks. And collectively, they represent then these something like p square positions that we need globally. So each processor allocates a number of arrays of size p, left and right margins of these ranges, the middle way in the range, the current pivot, and sigma for the sum of these m values. So then it locally initializes the search ranges to 0 to s size of local input size. And then we have this global iteration. The termination detection is basically a global OR reduction, checking whether there is any processor in any range where left and right end of the range have not converged yet. We call that, so Li at j means the left border for the ith rank considered at processor j, right? So that can be found locally in order p time, and then we can compute this local flag and do a global OR reduction about it. So that's a scalar valued collective communication operation. It's not that expensive. Now we have to pick a vector of pivots. That actually involves a reduction and a prefix sum and a broadcast, but it's all within the bound claimed, and I won't go into the details here. Then for each of the pivots vi, we perform a binary search within the ith range we store for our local sequence. So here come, that's basically where what we are doing this all for, that each processor only has to do binary search on its local data in each iteration. Then we are summing up these values in a vector-valued reduction operation. And now for each of the searches going on, I can locally decide which of the halves I'm taking. So for a second, let's go back to the analysis actually of sample sort, because I want to get you somehow back into context. Multi-way merge sort is not that different from it, right? We have basically what we like about the local work, it's perfect speed up. We have a quite reasonable communication volume. We have to send all the data once, and we will later see in this lecture why there's a factor two we have here. But the bad news is that we have p startup latencies, which severely limits scalability. And if you go back to this plot we had, we are talking about P equals 2 to the 18 in these measurements. And 2 to the 18 startup overheads are prohibitively expensive. So we will actually need, so the sample sort and multi-way merge sort thing I told you is a good sorting algorithm for large inputs, but not on this number of machines. So I will later outline a refinement that gets you actually to those algorithms. So now we are in the place where I have shown to you the basic algorithms that I view the right thing to teach at a basic parallel algorithms class. And now I want to get you just a hint of advanced sorting algorithms, which will wrap up our chapter on parallel sorting. So before going on this case of huge number of processors and large inputs, let's go back to highly scalable algorithms. So we had this ugly trade-off between an inefficient algorithm with logarithmic latency and an efficient one, namely quick sort with log square P latency. And I just want to outline to you why there might be a way to get the best of both worlds, an asymptotically efficient parallel sorting algorithm with latency log P that works efficiently, at least asymptotically, for n equals order P. And again, I will look only at the theoretician's case, n equals P, to slightly simplify things. And to further simplify things, I will assume a very strong model of computation, namely concurrent read, concurrent write PRAMs. So it's also randomized, and we will exploit that we can very quickly sort square root P elements. We will use that for something like sample sort, but a very fast variant of sample sort. So we take a sample of size square root P and sort it in logarithmic time. In order to have reasonable load balance, we will now choose something like square root P divided log by log P splitters. For this choice of number of splitters, one can show that the buckets will have size at most C times P over K for some constant C. We are allocating now buckets that can hold twice as much data. Okay? So, yeah, maybe you can think about what's the problem in now doing implementing sample sort in a scalable way. And we do it in an odd way. Maybe you think it's odd. We do it in an odd way that circumvents this problem that I would like to ask you to think about yourself. So what we are doing now is each processor takes its local elements and performs, well, we have a sorted array of PIVOs, right? That's no problem. And even in a concurrent read exclusive write machine, each processor can just access a single global array of splitters to perform a binary search in it, right? And now it knows a bucket ID. And it now writes the classified element in the right bucket. So that's each bucket represents an array whose size is twice the size we actually need. And what it does, it writes it into a random free position within this bucket. And it has a success probability of at least one half, and it basically repeats this until it is successful, in expectation it will need constant time to position an element into a bucket. Okay, and then we globally synchronize the processor when they have finished placing their data into buckets. And now we are compactifying these buckets, they are only half full on the average, right? Or less than that, perhaps. That we can do using prefix sums. So each processor's, a set of processes is allocated to each bucket. They are finding the empty elements and can compactify this in logarithmic time. And now we are doing a recursion. Depending on the size of each bucket, we are allocating a number of processors to each bucket that can be done in logarithmic time also, and we recurse. Yes? So what we have is a recursive algorithm that's doing something like sample sort. For reasons I'm asking you to think about, we cannot afford to split into p pieces, which gives us a single pass algorithm, but we split into something like less than square root p paces. But it's a, what's important, it's a power of p. And you might think, well, here's logarithmic latency for one recursion level. So, and there's a certain number of recursion levels. Why does he claim it's overall log p? So I didn't do the details here. Let's discuss about this in the flipped classroom lecture. Maybe think about the number of levels of recursion of this algorithm and think why it's still logarithmic time. And I don't expect that you really solve it, but maybe think about it, and I will explain later why, what's happening there. But let me give you an example so that this gets a bit more easy to understand. So we have this input array of characters. The boldface elements are the sample elements. They are maybe also using some prefix sum stuff compacted into a single compact array. Well, since it's very short, we can use a fast inefficient sorting algorithm to sort it, and we're extracting a subset of them as pivots, in that case only two. We allocate in buckets that are more than big enough to allocate all the elements, and then each processor goes through a number of elements, it places data randomly into the buckets. Then we have this compactification step, so getting that data back into dense arrays, and we are recursing. So that's this one extreme. Still reasonably simple algorithm running in logarithmic latency. They are, theoretically speaking, even better algorithms. For example, Cole has found an ingenious version of parallel merge sort that even on an exclusive read, exclusive write PRAM achieves running time order n over p plus log p. And by the way, in the textbook of Jaja, there is a reasonably understandable variant of that algorithm for CREW PRAMs. So the idea is to do a kind of pipeline parallel merge sort, where you use a deterministic sampling algorithm to predict where to take data from. There's also another approach to parallel sorting, that's sorting networks. So it's basically a circuit consisting of simple elements that can just sort two elements. So it's things that get two elements as input, output them in sorted order. And you can connect these simple elements to networks that are guaranteed to sort the input. They are very simple and elegant ones that have def log square n and size n log square n. One is, for example, the Bitonic sorting network that is the basis of one of the algorithms I have shown you in our experiment. That was this algorithm here. It's not competitive, but it gives you a reasonable parallel sorting algorithm. But from a theoretical point of view, more interesting is that they are very complicated sorting networks that actually have only def log n and size order n log n.
Ah, yes, and this Bitonic sorting you can convert into a sorting algorithm for larger inputs. You use the same network, but you say, oh, the elements are the inputs to these sorter, two-way sorters are basically sorted sequences. And then the operation they do is they perform a merge and then split into the larger half and the bigger half. About these theoretical ones, kind of interesting thing is that the constant factor is more like 10,000. And that's interesting, right? I mean, we are asking about an improvement of a log n factor. Suppose n is 2 to the 64, then log n is 64. So we have for realistic input size an improvement by at most a factor 64 from the asymptotics. But the constant factor we get in is a couple of thousands. So this is one of the famous examples where asymptotics is kind of misleading, but still it's interesting that this is possible. Okay, another story is what happens if you are sorting integers. Already in sequential algorithms, then you can get close to linear work, and that also extends to parallel sorting algorithms. Actually, for the minimum spanning tree algorithm, we will see towards the end of the lecture, we are using one of these results. In particular, on concurrent read, concurrent write PRAMs, they are also very fast algorithms that have a latency that even goes far below log number of elements, but it's maybe more theoretical result. What's practically more interesting is a generalization of sample sort and merge sort that do multiple passes. So, for example, for sample sorts, this means we are not partitioning into p pieces with a latency of alpha times p, but maybe into square root p pieces with a latency of something like square root p times alpha, or maybe into p to the 1 over 3 pieces and a latency of alpha times p to the 1 over 3. And that's actually which gets you to these algorithms here. Our variant of that approach is the AMS sorting algorithm. Is based on sample sort. And for this number of processors, I think it's optimal to have something like three or four passes, which means that you have p to the 1 over 3 or p to the 1 over 4 buckets in the first level of recursion. And then actually for large inputs, we get better than quicksort because we are saving on communication bandwidth, but we are paying with latency. And this Hooke-Sort algorithm is a competing algorithm that achieves very similar performance for random inputs. Actually, it's slightly faster than ours in this case. But actually, it doesn't work for arbitrary inputs. Whereas for our algorithm, we have proven and also experimentally evaluated that basically this performance curve we get for arbitrary inputs. So I've also shown this plot in a slightly different way here. It's basically, by the way, all plots made by Michael Axmann. That's part of his PhD thesis. So here we have divided the running times by the running time of the best algorithm for each input size. And then we get this thing here that the gather-based algorithm is best here. The fast independent sorting algorithm is never worse than twice as slow as this algorithm. It's the best up to here. Then the quicksort algorithm is in this input size, like 2 to the minus 2 elements per processor, so like something like 3.5 times slower than our fast inefficient sorting algorithm.
So that's kind of the worst case we observe in this range of inputs, right? Where the second best algorithm is 3.5 times slower than the best one. In the medium range, quicksort is best. And somehow the most interesting point is around here, where the second best algorithm, in that case, bytonic sorting, is a factor of 3 worse. And the AMS sorting algorithm is also a factor of about 3 worse. And if we discount the bytonic thing because it's actually dominated by the others, we would have a factor of 6. You would insist of using only fast, inefficient, and AMS sort, right? And then for the largest inputs, quicksort is up to 2.5 times slower than the best algorithms, these multi-pass sample sort algorithms. So that brings me to the end of the chapter on parallel sorting. The next chapter is collective communication. We have already seen broadcast and reduction. And I will now show you further operations because we already used them several times for matrix multiplication and parallel sorting. In particular, I will explain to you how prefix sums work. I will not explain to you how gather and scatter work because they are more simple. I will show you a more powerful operation, namely gossiping, also called all gather or all to all broadcast, which is a gather followed by a broadcast operation. And then we have a particular focus on the general all-to-all personalized communication, which we used in particular for the data exchange step in sample sort and multi-way merge sort. We will begin with the equal message length thing, but then also talk about the arbitrary